I have been with Freedom Foundation now for 2 years. I started out originally doing oppositional research for them and working out of Washington. We've been in the state of Washington for 25 years, worked with them for a couple of years now. Last summer, we opened our office here in Oregon, so we're now a multi-state regional sort of player. And we started because we recognized that progressives move back and forth between Oregon and Washington with reckless abandon. They don't recognize the Columbia River as a border, and we needed to do the same. 2 years ago, we started a very focused plan to take on public sector unions because they have a huge undue influence in the political cycle. And one of the brochures that I passed around to many of you, if you don't have one in front of you, grab one. I have extras. This right here, this brochure, we'll talk about that here in a moment. But our number one stated focus is to defund the political left. And I'm going to say this right now. Every time I speak publicly, this is going to sound paranoid and all of that. The unions know that where I go, and they follow me, and they send a plant. So if you're here, I hope you quote me right this time. So wherever you are in this room, our goal is to defund you.
Yeah.
And get your fingers out of the political cycle and make it a fair playing field. Get it right this time on your nasty little websites. So that's our goal. We have a four-point plan, and I want to go through it with you here today. And the first thing I want to show you, and I'm getting kind of oriented here, is right here at the top here. Let's do that. Let's make it so you can see it. Let's double click. Can you see that okay? Undue influence. This is the Washington version of the same brochure. As I talk about our four-point plan, I'm going to talk interchangeably between Oregon and Washington. What Washington's been doing, they're about 18 months ahead of what we've been doing here in Oregon. And I'm going to say that not to discourage you and make us feel like we're the redheaded stepchild of Freedom Foundation or not, but I want you to get a vision of, imagine what's going to happen in 18 months here in Oregon, the more we work our plan here. It's a good thing. So some of the undue influence sorts of things that, yes, sir? Okay. Right here, this is the Washington version of the brochure you have here. We did a poll of union members in Washington, and they're about what we would expect for polling a population, about 50-50 Democrat-Republican. You can see that right there. 46% of union members voted for, over on the left, I don't even recognize the governors. They voted for McKenna versus Jay Inslee. Jay Inslee's on the right. There's about 50-50. If you look below that, you can see the disparity in how unions spent their money on campaigns. They gave $18.3 million to Jay Inslee, and on the right, they gave $5.8 to his competitor, Rod McKenna. So there, even though 50% of union members, 50-50 Democrat-Republican union dollars, go typically towards left-leaning campaigns. So there's a little picture of the undue influence in Washington. They also spent about 78% on anti-McKenna expenditures. We call those, they call them something expenditures in Washington. We would call them in-kind donations here.
Independent
expenditures, there you go. I've learned to speak the language. Here's the Oregon version of the same thing. We just finished up doing this. Again, you have a copy of this in front of you. On the left, that's the big number right there. Unions spend about $746,000 supporting John Kitzhaber. They spent $555 towards Richardson. And those were not direct. That was like pack to pack. I chased all those numbers down. It was pack to pack to pack. The top players in those contributions, Citizen Action for Political Education, CAPE. If you look that up in Orstar, it sounds like this really nice kind of pack. It's not. It's an aggregating sort of pack where unions just plug in money. AFSCME, SEIU, OEA. A couple more in there. So it's an aggregating pack. Second, if that weren't enough for SEIU, then they're the number two contributors, AFT, local, AFL-CIO, and on and on. Huge numbers for that. And then the next slide we have here is kind of a comparison. I'm going to kind of skip out on the left because that's the Washington version, but on the right, again, this is on your brochure there. You can see in yellow, who here knows Brent Barton? Are we in his district right now?
Yep.
Okay, I thought so. If we're not, we're like, it's right down the road.
Yeah.
All of that yellow represents union money in his pack. for those of us who know Steve Newgard, he didn't, I mean, how do you compete against that, right? Is Steve here?
Not tonight.
Darn, I'm going to see him.
He told me he was coming.
I know, he told me too. So seriously, how do you compete against that? If you take the yellow out of it, then it's a fair fight. That's where the idea of undue influence comes in. Everybody on that list won their race except for Jamie Damon, and she won a nice cushy job at the state, if I recall, right? I know. I'm not sure how the timing out of this goes. It's delayed a little bit. I don't need to tell yet. Can you see what the next slide is? So we have a four-point plan. I just kind of introduced to you some of kind of the money aspect of it. There's 4 points to it: legislate, litigate, activate, educate. And so that's what these little pill. And I don't know what these all mean, but that's, we're kind of going through that four-point plan now. Here's the legislation part. This is what we've done in the state of Washington. We introduced 6 bills, and of course they went nowhere. One of them managed to get through a Senate hearing, creating a digital library for all government union CBA. CBA stands for collective bargaining agreements. So you can see what your contract is that you have with union. So we were working on that in Oregon. I'm just kind of getting that started. We got a little bit behind the eight ball on that for this session. And plus this session is so crazy because it's a short session. We're not going to get much introduced at all. But the next session we will. And yes, people say, why are you even trying? You're not going to get a hearing. And my answer is, yes, I will get a hearing. And it's so fun to listen to union people, union representatives come in and defend their crazy ideas and getting them on tape and shaming them, which we really like to do. So 2015, more bills that they introduced in Washington. Again, this is think about this in 18 months here in Oregon. This is what we want to get going. 16 bills for 2016 in Washington. Oregon, we're special. We realized when we started in Oregon, one of our biggest obstacles was public records. In Washington, we got spoiled. We can ask for a public record and we get it. We don't get it, we can sue for it, and we get it and we get paid legal fees for when there's non-compliance. Pretty rigorous Public Records Act. We have actually pretty rigorous Public Records Act here, but nobody obeys it. So you might have noticed me in the news about that. I'm suing DHS in the state of Oregon, I believe SEIU, or just DHS. DHS at this point,
just
I think.
DHS this time.
About their finagling a public records law. That's a long story, and I only have a few minutes. So there's going to be more of that, and we'll talk about that more in just a minute. But we have gone around to major media outlets all over the state of Oregon. You can also add the Statesman Journal to that. And we have said to them, folks, public records, public access to public records is very important. All of these, plus the Statesman Journal, have written editorials and op-eds on this and have made it very clear that they agree with us. So we have the media behind this. Obviously, we've gotten a lot of media. Here's one that just came out on December 3rd. This was the first one. There's the right there in the middle, how state officials with guidance from the Department of Justice kneecapped a public records request. They're specifically talking about my public records request. And the her in there is me, talking about how her public records runaround has made two things clear to Oregonians. First, Oregon needs to update not only its public records law, but also its government culture. I mean, this is an Oregonian. This is crazy to me, Senate. Second, Rosenblum, who's up for election next year, really needs a first-rate opponent. Boom. That was, you guys, I read that, and like, I knew that editorial was made favorable. I had no idea. And I emailed her, I said, thank you. That was great. That, I knew that one was coming. The second one that came was around Christmas time. It was on December 29th. Continued media coverage, I gotta hit the button again. The Oregonian on the 29th said, the first one they excoriated Rosenblum, the second one they went after Governor Brown. If Brown meant what she said February 18th, she would not have tolerated the public records abuse in which her workforce and labor policy advisor was complicit. We have found out that her labor policy analyst didn't like my public record request and was complicit in keeping that information from me. Nor would she now be defending it. She'd also be willing to say whether she knew about it. It wouldn't be more, couldn't be more clear, however, that Brown's avowed commitment to transparency was nothing more than inaugural window dressing. So we're going to keep putting that pressure on those, but this is what we spent the first year kind of laying the basis for getting public records. Why do we want public records? We'll talk about that in just a moment. What's next? Policy publications. This is part of our educate, part of our goal with Freedom Foundation, is to let folks like you, folks out there, folks, anybody, know what is going on with unions and the abuses that they have. We've done employee freedom, letting employees know, hey, did you know that you can become an agency fee payer? You can have parts of your dues not go towards political expenditures. Grading teachers union contracts, minimum wage law, that's been really huge. Gosh, who's behind that $15 minimum wage thing? Mandatory paid sick leave. Unionizing the shared economy. We saw that, unionizing the shared economy. If you talk to anyone that was in the legislature a year ago, and the huge amount of Bureau of Labor and Industry abuses that came down, the paid sick leave, the $15 minimum wage, what was the other one, the sweet cakes thing, all of those abuses that came out of that, comes from that. It's making the private sector become more union-like. And voter guides, those are a lot of the publications, and I have more as well, but that's part of our educate. Mass outreach and training. Out these things. Many of you guys know what's going on. Implementing Harris versus Clinton. I'm going to talk about that here in just a minute. We just did in the state of Washington, letting public teachers know about their decertification and disassociation rights. Did you know a union can decertify? If you ask members, they don't. Oh, I can do that? Yeah, it's been a long time since you've been able to do it. I know, I'm sorry, I've only got a few moments. Come talk to me. Equipping grassroots activists. Am I in the right place? Yes. In Washington and Oregon, letting you know what we can do to undo this influence. Because here's the thing about this sort of influence in politics, is it affects every single issue that's important to us. It affects voter registration and voter integrity. It affects Metro. It affects property values and property use. It affects education. It affects all of that undue influence. If we can solve some of this, makes all of your issues that much easier. Would you agree?
Yes.
Okay, good. I'm here to help. All right, next. Video storytelling. Well, this, I have tons of these videos. I want to show you a couple. These are actual union members in the state of Washington. I'm telling you guys, this keeps me up at night. I need to find union members in the state of Oregon willing to tell their story. I'm asking you to help me with that. And the reason why, it's really easy to say, yeah, I'll go do it. It's another thing to do it, because we can all agree that unions also broker in fear. They will come and scare you. They'll come and knock on your door in the middle of the night and things like that. They do that. We're here to help you, and we'll help you out with that, okay? So I want to show a few of these. I don't know if I want to show this one, so I'm going to skip ahead. I want to show you one that we showed during October. Not this guy. One second. I can't multitask too much. Mary Jane. The reason why I want you to hear Mary Jane's story, she's like 72 years old, and she is your grandmother. She is so sweet. We showed this ad in the Eugene Market and the Salem Market during Ducks games in October. So it was really great. But again, I really would like to have Oregonians on these. So anyway, so you can see what the kind of ads we're doing. What's that?
The sound is
open. It is. Okay, ready?
My name is Mary Jane Olson, and I have 10 grandchildren who all live in the area. My grandson was born in 2000. He had been progressing very normally and was talking and feeding himself and saying, I love you, Grandma. And about age 3, he started requiring a lot of medical attention, and he was diagnosed then with autism. I started filling in and taking care of him on a regular basis. At the end of 2008, I signed up with DSHS to become a caregiver through the state of Washington. When I went into the DSHS office on Broadway and Everett, I filled out the packet, and then I was handed a separate slip that had SEIU's name on it and told, okay, here's the union contract for you to sign. So I looked at it and I said, I don't want to do that now. I said, I want to take this home and have my husband look at it. And she says, well, okay, but you should. And I said, no, I don't want to join the union. And so I left it, and I didn't sign it. When I received my first paycheck from DSHS, I was shocked to see that union dues were being withheld from my paycheck, because I knew that I had not signed authorizing them to deduct any payment to SEIU at all. I went through the process in my own mind of, okay, what do I do now? Should I call them up and say, you know, this is wrong, and demand to have them stop immediately? But my problem with doing that was I didn't want any repercussions in my daughter receiving care for my grandson. I just decided to accept it at this time anyway and see what happened down the road. I first learned about the Harris versus Quinn ruling in a bulletin that was sent by the Freedom Foundation. When I received that, I said, how am I able to participate in that? I would like to opt out of SEIU. I received a letter from them saying that there's a specific form that you need to fill out. As soon as I got my hands on that, I took care of that within the first 30 minutes. I never wanted to join SEIU in the first place. I disagree with their politics. I resented having money out of my paycheck taken to support candidates that I don't support. I do not want to support the union in any way. I won't support them with my vote, and I sure don't want to support them with my money.
That's the longer version of that ad. We have a shorter 30-second version.
I really feel...
Oh, sorry. I'm going to skip ahead 1 second. There's a bunch of ads here, and we have obviously on and on. We can go, sorry, multitasking again. But I wanted to give you an idea of what these folks are like so that you can see if you know someone with any sort of union injustice story. We would love to talk to them, and we would love to tell their story, and we would love to be brave for them. They did try to intimidate Mary Jane. Who goes and intimidates a 72-year-old grandmother?
Union.
So just to give you an idea, we do have opt-out forms, but I wanted to also show you this right here. I put a bunch of these out on the table. I have thousands of these. If you want these, let me know, because I want to get rid of them. But this is what our... let me just back up a little bit. We have canvassers going door-to-door around the state of Oregon right now, letting people like Mary Jane know that they can opt out. They take with them an opt-out form, and they take this with them. So if they are starting to have a good conversation with one of these folks at the door, and they can show them where their union money is going to. And this has had a great effect. But this isn't just, I mean, this is for everybody. Last year, I believe Nick just told me, SEIU 503, which is the main union here in Oregon, $30 million. So when you think about when they have opt-outs that take $300 to $500 a year out of that $30 million, and it starts happening in great numbers, you bet they're threatened, and we're happy to do that. So if you want these, I got tons of those. Not so much of these, we have to get a reprint of those, but I do have handfuls I can give. So, but let me just step in there. I know that Harris versus Quinn is going to come in here in just a moment. For those of you who don't know, who doesn't know what Harris versus Quinn is? Okay, Harris versus Quinn is a Supreme Court decision that came out in July of 2014. And it says home health care workers, child care workers, who receive some sort of, depending on what state you're in, a Medicaid, Medicare sort of payment to do exactly what Mary Jane is doing, taking care of someone in their home. They don't need to be unionized. SEIU across the nation went through, it happened in 2008 here, went across a lot of these states and said, hey, there are state workers that are receiving state money, and unionized them. And many of the times that was done nefariously. So, Supreme Court decisions came out, and in 9 times in that decision in 2014, called it a scheme. And so they are one of the few populations of SEIU members who can 100% opt out without losing any of their benefits. And you bet I want to tell those people about that right. So that's what we're doing in the state of Washington. We have devastated some of the SEIU's populations, because if you let anyone know, no matter what political flavor they are, across the board, that they have the right to opt out and save money, they do. It's a good thing. So we'll talk about that here in a second. But here's some of the other things that we're doing in terms of educating. Who here went to Freedom Academy last month, 2 months ago? Oh, come on, I know more of you did. Right. I know Richard was there. I know you were there. Some of you were there. Oh, yeah, that's right. Freedom Academy, myself and my boss, Scott Roberts, who's our Citizen Action Director, went all over the state of Oregon in this week-long rock star kind of tour and met with activists all over the state of Oregon to encourage them to get involved and to run for local office. So that was a lot of fun. And I slept for a week after that because that was kind of a lot in 1 week. Oh, here we go. I have to hit this like 5 times. La la la. One more. There we go. I knew that was going to happen. What these are, I wanted to show you. These are the forms that I have folks take to the door, our canvassers, our canvassing effort. I want to talk a lot about our canvassing effort. Right there on the left is the manual that we use in Washington. On the right is the one we use in Oregon. So if you want to become a canvasser, I'm going to talk to you about that booklet. Right there is the opt-out form. That one, I believe, is for Washington. I'm sure it is because it is. And there's the same, the Washington version of the form I just gave you, letting people know where their union dollars are going to. It goes to places like, yes, Planned Parenthood. It goes to really crazy left sorts of causes that a lot of people may not agree with, such as Black Lives Matter, things. You know, wherever you stand on that issue, it's not fun knowing that your dollars that you're forced to pay are going to places like that. So it's just informing them. This is the form you have in front of you, so we'll skip over that. Here's the other thing we've noticed. When we have let people know that they can, this is WFSE, WFSE, that's a conglomeration of unions in Washington. When we let people know they opt out and then they opt out, then it's funny, the union comes back around and says, no, you got to opt back in. We need you. Come on, you know, union strong and all that. And they start really harassing those former members. And so we've had to send out pieces to let them know, come off your doorstep. You don't have to do that. And so what I want you to kind of capture is we do try to take care of these workers and SEIU members and not just take their money and run. In fact, we don't take their money. Everything we do for workers is free. So from doorstep to on, we will help people, especially if they have a union injustice story. Because I remember talking to a former member in Washington said, I just opted back in so they would leave me alone. Isn't that sad? Only SEIU does that. Okay, I got to bring her. Choose your state. We also have a website, opt out. Many of you have seen this online. That's what it looks like. Opt out today, opt out now, opt out Oregon. We've bought all of those. So if you know someone, you're like, oh my gosh, Amory, where can I send them? Opt out today, opt out now, pick any of those. This is what it looks like. This is our door-to-door numbers. As of in Oregon for 2015. Keep in mind, we just started our canvassing effort in October. I'm going to disagree with that top number. It says 56 people have opted out. That's not true. It's like 215 have opted out because we get the forms at our office. Just since October, with about 10 people canvassing around the state, over 200 people, I hear you. A lot of people want more information. We've had live contacts at the door of almost 700 total visited, 13, almost 1,400 doors. I gotta hurry. December door-to-door. When you talk about opting out, especially in the state of Washington, where we've had the program going since the beginning of June, we're talking a range of about $690,000 to $1.7 million no longer in SEIU's pockets. That is taking union dollars out of the political cycle. That's our goal, and we're doing it. So I'm going to hurry here. I've got two more slides. Okay. I'm going to skip that. You guys know we're done. Come on. Okay, I gotta tell you about this. This is so funny. SEIU 925. There's two unions in Washington, two SEIUs. 925 is the one that represents child care workers. We sent this mailer out, I believe, like November, because we cut their population in half. So we sent this is an awesome mailer. Sent out a mailer to the rest of them saying, don't be on a sinking ship. And they've also had to increase their dues by like a 47% to make up for the loss of funds. For the people who are still remaining, they're on the sinking ship and they're paying more dues to make up for the losses. So we let them know that. So SEIU 925, many other union members are saying Freedom Foundation. SEIU 925 is the union that, what is it, Freedom Foundation killed or something like that?
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
We're talking about $1.3 million with that. So imagine that here in Oregon in 18 months. Would you get chills a little bit? I know. All right, come on. I got one more. I know. One more. Okay, oh, I'm sorry. I knew that was going to happen. What you just saw, go by. You can't do this to unions without blowback. They're going to come back, and so what you just saw was a mailer that just went by really fast. The day before Thanksgiving, oh, there it is. The day before Thanksgiving, Tom McCabe is our CEO. If you ever want to have Tom McCabe come and speak, I'm happy to. He's an amazing leader of our organization. They sent this mailer to his neighborhood, to about the several hundred houses in his neighborhood, to his church, to his personal friends, about how awful he is. If you've been on social media, the Northwest Accountability Project, that they totally, that's them behind all of this. You know what? These are badges of honor to us. You know when you're poking the bees and they come out with stuff like that, you know you're doing something right. So that just inflames us and makes us go further. So I'm going to keep hurrying because I have a call to action at the end, and that's where I want to get. Come on. Looking forward in Oregon. Come on, one more. We are growing our canvassing effort. Why? Because I put some newsletters out on your table. I have a few. It's the newspaper-looking thing. The centerfold talks about Friedrichs. Friedrichs is another Supreme Court decision that's supposed to be coming down here this summer that would make it that all state employees can opt out of their unions 100%. We're hoping it goes our way. We are the only ones in the country that are doing this sort of canvassing grassroots door-to-door effort, and we want to boost our canvassing team to be ready for it. I'm looking for canvassers. I need more. I'm having a training on January 20th, a week from Wednesday, 6:30, at our Salem office. Please come talk to me. I would like to hire you. We will pay you to canvass and talk to these folks. When I talked to them on the phone, I'm not kidding, I was in tears today just about talking to this woman who's just about homeless because of all the shenanigans with DHS, and she's like, I would like to get my union money back because I can buy groceries this weekend. I mean, oh my word, these people who are home health care workers are not rich. I'm not either, but geez. I am looking for people to be willing to tell their stories, highlighting union, any sort of union injustice stories, and it doesn't have to always be SEIU. Looking for plaintiffs and lawsuits. One of the main things that we do that keeps the left on their toes is we sue them and make them spend their resources on us and not on your campaigns. You're welcome. We're also drafting legislation for 2017, and again, that's very embryonic. And again, we just got started, so we weren't able to get into this session. But that's what we do. Please come talk to me, and especially canvassing, advertising or plaintiffs, litigation, any of these things that sound interesting to you, please come talk to me. And again, January 20th, 6:30 at our Salem office, I will give you more details. There you go.